Good afternoon. Today's colloquium is dedicated to applied mathematics. I have pleasure to introduce Dr. Norden Huang from the Laboratory for Hydrospheric Processes of the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. Dr. Huang got his PhD on fluid mechanics and mathematics at Johns Hopkins in 1967. Then he made a postdoc at the University of Washington in Seattle in oceanography. And then from 69 to 75, he continued to work on oceanography and fluid mechanics at North Carolina University. In 1975, he joined NASA, where he has been since, except for a 2 year, 97-98, where he was at Caltech as a visiting professor. Dr. Huang is a member of the National Academy of Engineering. The title of his talk today is A New Method for Nonlinear and Non-Stationary Time Series Analysis, the Hilbert Spectral Analysis. Dr. Huang.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure for me to visit here. I've heard about CERN for many, many years, and this morning I have a chance to see the some of the experiment. It's really awesome. Compared to the kind of experiment that I have been doing, it's really mind-boggling. In the past, I have been doing some experimental study as well as theoretical analysis on water waves primarily. Water waves is nonlinear water waves, and its generation, its propagation, its evolution, and its statistics. The reason I study that is that NASA is trying to use satellite to study ocean, and the radar signal bounced back from the surface are always random, and they want to find out exactly what this number means. And so I've been doing that even before I joined NASA. I've used the standard statistical method using Fourier spectrum, using distribution, probability distribution. All the method I use, the more I use, the less I like it, because they all have some assumptions. The assumptions basically are either linear or stationary, and or both. Only recently, there are methods that deviate away from these two restrictions. Some of the method is deviate away from the stationarity, and others deviate away from the linearity. But few will do both. Now, today, I'm trying to discuss a simple, very simple method that I come up with, which I think will give us a little bit handle on seeing what the time series data from a nonlinear and non-stationary process can give us, the information. The data analysis is important for me as an experimentalist and also for the theoretical side, because the data is the only thing that connects me to the reality. So to look at this, in the past, however, people, as I said, making assumptions, say, all right, assume this process is linear but non-stationary. For that, there are many methods available. For example, the method, a spectrogram, wavelet analysis, even though this is relatively new, but in about 15 to 20 years, this now becomes almost the mainstream of the thing. I believe some of you are familiar with that. A weak and wild distribution and the evolutionary spectrum. This is a invention of a statistician, Priestley, and empirical orthogonal function. All of these methods are under one assumption, is that the time series has to be linear. And only recently, I found two books talk about nonlinear time series analysis. And one book is by Howard Tan, the other book is by Dix. Both just appeared very recently. However, when you talk with them, she says, all right, you talk about nonlinear time series. Are these time series non-stationary? They said, no, no, no. This is a stationary but linear. What they did was actually study the time series come from low-dimensional nonlinear systems to see the chaos and whatever. So a few years ago, I started to play with a method. I started to play with Hilbert transform. And this is a standard transformation that is, if we have x equal to LP, p larger than 0, you do this transformation, find the Cauchy principal value, then I give you y, then this xy form a complex conjugate. And once you form a complex conjugate, then you can write this in a polar coordinate. This is A is the envelope, and EI theta is the face. And if the data can be translated into that form, then I will have the energy as function of time, and if theta, time derivative of theta is my frequency, then I'll have frequency as function of time. Then that would be very nice, I thought. However, all the books talk about this method of Hilbert transform at the time that I start to play with it, they all warn, don't use it. Like, for example, a standard book on random data analysis is by Bandad and Parasol. And in chapter 12, it talk about non-stationary data, and chapter 13 talk about Hilbert transform, and after that is the appendix. And they never use the method for any data. Why? The reason is very simple. You see, if I only take a very simple sine wave, but the sine wave has a different reference. The case A is reference here, case B is reference off the center, case C is outside the trough of the wave. And if I make a Hilbert transform of that, all the data Hilbert transform is the circle. And the only difference is that the axis, x and y axis, for case A, the center is here. For case B, the y axis moves to here. For case C, y axis moves outside the circle. Now when you track this, this phase angle, you will get something very strange. For example, like in case C, from this point to that point, your phase is increased. From this point to this point, your phase actually decreases. So your phase increase will never go beyond 2 pi. And if we plot the phase, we find that for case A, the phase is the straight line, the green line. For case B, it's wavering. For case C, it's never go beyond 2 pi. And if we take this and we say, well, take the derivative of phase as the frequency, we'll get the 3 different frequency value from the same sine wave. Case A, I have a constant. Case B, I have up and down value. And case C, this is 0. Here is 0, 0 line. I'll have many negative frequency value as well as positive value. And so for a given signal, my frequency can be anything. And this method actually has been used. I recently found a book by Stephanie Hahn, and the book is called Hilbert Transformation, colon, with application to data analysis. And this book actually just take any data, do a Hilbert transformation, and take the derivative. So you have both positive and negative frequency, and which really doesn't make sense. And if we look, this is very simple data. If we have a more complicated data like this, and if we want to use Hilbert transform, what we're going to have is this. See, for example, any of the wave beyond the mean is case C. Any of the asymmetric wave is case B. And we try to find a case A, you will find that the likelihood is 0. And if you make the transformation of this data into the complex space, what you have is many, many swirls away from 0. And if you take a derivative of that, you will get as many negative frequency as you get positive. So it doesn't make sense anymore. Now, how can we actually use the nice Hilbert transform and apply it to the data? That's what I come in with, a very simple procedure. The need is to pre-process the data. And the pre-processing, I'll give you an example like this. This is a time series, a simpler time series, but I will use it as an example because this we can see the operation. Here, zero is here. We have all this time series, and of course we have, we can find, when we look at the time series, the typical question we want to ask is, what kind of time scale this process represents? What is the energy distribution as function of time or frequency, the inverse of time? Now, to define time scale, we can of course use zero crossing, or we can use the distance, but if we use zero crossing, then we'll miss the small change over here. Or for example, use zero crossing, we'll miss all this small change. So if we go beyond zero crossing, then the next statistical measure is the distance between extremas. The maximum to maximum to local maximum to local maximum. That would be a much finer definition. And if we want to go beyond that, we can look at the extrema of curvatures. Yeah. I have done all of that, but for this illustration, I will just use the extrema. To use extrema, what I did was I'm doing a very simple operation. I will locate all the extrema, and then I will connect all the local maximum by one curve. This curve is a cubic spline, and cubic spline maintain the continuity of the data, continuity of the derivative, and continuity of curvature. And then, using the same way, I will connect all the minimum with another curve. And this minimum and maximum envelope actually cover all the data. But once I cover the data, then I will take the mean of the maximum and minimum and draw this line, this black line, this dark black line. And dark black line is my running mean. However, this mean I did not get by averaging. I get by the envelope. So this mean is local. If the sequence, if the time series is non-stationary, there's no time scale for us to make mean. So we cannot take mean. So by doing this mean, I get around the time scale requirement. And once I define this black line, then what I can do is to take the difference between the data and this black line. That, by doing that, I will get a function like this. This function has some very interesting properties. The property number one is that it has the same number of extrema and zero crossing. In other words, that's by construction, because you have all the maximum is connected by one line, all the minimum connected by another line. And I go right in the middle. So this line, this green line, is the base. It's our zero line, which is that black line. So I move my reference to this green line. So my maximum and minimum are all separate on either side. Not only that, and the envelope of this curve is symmetric. And that's again by construction. Okay. In the past, if you look at a standard statistic book, they will say that if the process is Gaussian, and if it's stationary, if the extrema number and the zero crossing number equals, then this data has a narrow band. But this data is not exactly narrow band. There are some very small period and very large period. So the bandwidth is finite. I've looked for a name of this kind of function. I failed to find it in my meager collection of statistical book, so I just give it a definition. I define this function as the intrinsic mode function. The intrinsic mode function is any function having the same number of extrema and zero crossing, and it has a symmetric envelope defined by maximum minimum. And this function enjoys good Hilbert transform, and then we can write that function equal to AT EI theta T. Then we will not have this loop around. But that, it's not the end, because I now only take the delta difference between delta and this mean. This mean contains a lot of information too. So if I want to get all the information from the data, I have to deal with that mean. So what I did was that I proposed a sifting process. The sifting process is that the data minus mean 1, which is that big black line, I get C1. And then I take M1 over here, and I repeat the procedure. Identify all the extrema, and connect all the maximum, and connect all the minimum, and then to get a mean, its mean, which is mean 2. Then mean 1 minus mean 2 gets C2. I can repeat this process to the nth step. By the time I get to the nth step, what happened is that this mean becomes either a monotonic function or a constant. Then I stop. At that time, I add all together. What happens? All this mean canceled. All I have is delta minus this, the last trend, which, as I said, is either monotonic, constant, or it can only have one extrema. If I have two extrema, then I can draw a line. I have one extrema, I cannot do anything. So at that time, I will stop. So the delta minus whatever that trend equals to summation Cj. This summation Cj is the basis, becomes my basis to expand the data. And this, by comparison to, for example, the Fourier expansion. If I have data, I expand it in Fourier way. Then I'll have Aj, Ei omega j omega. And this A and omega are all constant. And if we expand out in this way, the xt, the ajt, ei omega tau d tau. So those A and omega are all variable. And this gives us a lot of freedom. And this freedom actually is very critical. However, this method is totally against the mathematical rule of game. The mathematician, I hope there are no mathematicians here, or there are some mathematicians, please bear with me. I think the mathematician is very different from my background. My background is engineering, even though I took some course in math. My interest is finding information. But the interest of mathematician is not information or truth. The interest of mathematician, the most important thing is consistent logic. Okay. We can draw two lines, which is two line parallel lines, we'll never meet. It's fine. Then we define a geometry. Those are the geometry that we torture the kids with, the Euclidean geometry. And if we draw two lines, this is a two parallel line meets, that's fine. We define different geometry. They are both good geometries. It depends upon which one you take. The mathematician would like you to take this kind of approach in which they define the basis a priori. You see, you want to expand something, define the basis. And once you prove the basis, complete basis, this basis, that, then you say, all right, expand it in that. But unfortunately, once you define the base, the expansion of your data into that base becomes curve fitting. There's no more physics involved. And in fact, many of the result does not have physical meaning. For example, this is a very dark room. If I turn all the lights off and I will play with this projector, I turn it on and off. And I will take the light meter here, I will measure for 10 seconds. take 100 points a second. 10 seconds take 1,000 points. And when I practice enough, I can turn it on or off right away. Now I get one blip, and I give to the spectral analysis people. Spectral analysis people give me a white spectrum for that one blip. And you ask them, what does this mean? So, well, the meaning is that you have 500 switches. Each one operates sinusoidally. At the moment that you have the switch on, you have a phase-locked signal that all the sine wave has a maximum over there. So it enforces. And all the other time, they cancel. Mathematically, it makes perfect sense. But physically, it's nonsense. Because this light and the sensor that I use, the light doesn't cancel. I don't have negative magnitude of light sensor. But the people look at the Fourier spectrum as a matter of fact. They say, well, that's the way it is. That's not the way it is. Okay. Especially when this thing is non-stationary and non-linear. Now, let's make another comparison. First, let's look at this Fourier. In the Fourier way of looking at the thing is that if I have data of any shape, and if I want to expand this data into Fourier spectrum, what I have is that I plot this as omega, this is my amplitude or amplitude square, and here is function of t. Then if I choose any frequency, because frequency is constant with respect to time, that constant is going to be maintained a constant all the way across. And that amplitude is, again, constant. So each Fourier component gives me a squared value. Okay. Therefore, there's no information along the time axis. The only thing is the projection on the omega A space. And that's our Fourier spectrum. Now, if, on the other hand, we look at a different presentation. For this presentation, however, I plot omega as a function of time, and at each time, the amplitude is also a function of time. Okay, so I will have, in omega A T space, I will have a different contour of energy, and this different contour energy actually represent the real data, the real property of the data. Now, having done this, and also have told you that I can strip the data into components, let me give you an illustration of how this stripping is done with a very simple example. Here is the data, which is much more complicated than what I have shown you. This data is from 1978 to 1988. And the vertical axis is length of day. And this is the length of day actually measured each day. The day is defined as rotating speed of the Earth. So the speed keeps changing. Okay, over 10 years is that much change. And the unit, however, is in microsecond. And for this data, if I decompose, use the program that use the sifting process that I propose, what I will have is that the highest frequency I got is this, and then the longer period is still a longer period until finally I get a trend. Now, this trend, I have very little to think that I can say because the data is very short. The longest period presumably could be 19.5 years, the metonic cycle of the sun and earth and moon. But if you look up, this is multi-year. This is 1 year. 1 year is 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, each 1 year. And then this is half yearly, and turns out these are monthly and bi-monthly time. The tidal force actually caused the Earth to rotate non-uniformly. Now, if you look at this, these are not sine wave. Those are the actually extract from the data. And this data, for example, some are bigger and some are small. This fluctuation in magnitude actually has physics in it. Mr. Delilah introduced me, I used to work in the ocean. So I know what happened in the ocean. And it turns out the largest one is 82-83. 82-83 turns out to be one of the largest El Nino years. Okay. The El Nino actually caused the atmosphere to have large perturbation, and that it actually changed the angular momentum of the Earth, and it caused the rotation speed to change. And if we try to add the data back, the data, and this is the last curve, and you add two, it becomes that, which almost look like a running mean, but it's not. I did not get it from running mean. And if you add annually, you see this annual cycle. Indeed, it has an annual cluster. But if you add one more, I get the biennial. And you see that indeed the biennial also appears. It's maximum, maximum over here. And you keep adding this. I will skip a few. If you add all seven, you get something like this. And this all seven, the difference between the all seven and the real data is 10 to the minus 15. So this decomposition, and you expand the data into this basis, actually is complete. Now, the data represent with a Hilbert transform, I called it Hilbert spectrum. And Hilbert spectrum can be compared with some other standard methods. I will show you some example from now. Here is an artificial example which has been used by many of the wavelet people, wavelet books. A sine of one frequency shifts the sine to another frequency. Okay? If we would use a Fourier spectrum, I plot here as function of time, here as frequency, and this is energy. As Fourier will not give us the time differentiation, so the Fourier spectrum show two peak from beginning to end, right? All right, and this example, because of that, the wavelet people say, no, This is not very good. You should use the wavelet analysis. Wavelet analysis, however, give you peak here, jump to peak here. It's a different frequency. So wavelet did represent the non-stationarity of the data better. However, for this data, if we use Hilbert spectrum, what do we got? We have a frequency here, jump frequency over there. It's very sharp. And if we integrate all the time and project the result onto the energy frequency space, then we can see the comparisons of the three methods. This is the Hilbert way. And the dynamic range of that, this is 2, this is 4, 6. This is almost 10 to the 4th. And the Fourier analysis perform amazingly good to tell you the frequency. And it has a dynamic range, maybe 10 to the 2 or 10 to the 1. And the wavelet give you just a slight hump. Now, there are different kind of wavelet, the discrete and the continuous. And the discrete wavelet is very good for data compression. But to see the features, you have to use continuous wavelet. The continuous wavelet is not orthogonal, it has lots of leakage. And because of the inherited conflict of wavelet, you want to be local so that the wavelet cannot contain many small waves. And If you do not contain many small waves, you lose on the resolution. So between the resolution and location, so you are suffering from the so-called uncertainty principle. Okay, we'll come back to that later. So the wavelet, actually, as far as looking for frequency or time frequency is concerned, it's probably not optimal. Okay, but the wavelet people, however, keep telling people, says, oh, you should definitely use wavelet because wavelet give you uniform resolution. The resolution is uniform because small wave, you have the same number of wave, and large wave, you also contain the same wave. So the frequency resolution is uniform, not like a spectrogram. You have a fixed window, so for high frequency, you have redundancy. For low frequency, you don't even cover one wave. Wavelet did away with that. But I think the honest way to describe wavelet should be wavelet give you uniformly poor resolution. The resolution is there, but it's uniformly poor. And we will see this in other examples. Now, I will use that example to just illustrate non-stationary. And I will now switch to discuss another problem. That problem is more related to the nonlinear process. And the example I give is very simple. I have x equal cosine omega t plus epsilon sine 2 omega t. Yeah, I perturbate the phase a little bit. Okay? Now once I perturbate that, then I can expand this out as cosine omega cosine epsilon sine epsilon. And when epsilon is small, the cosine small argument equal to 1, sine argument equals to argument, and then this relates to cosine omega cosine 3 omega, and so on. If you want to have more terms, you can keep on going. And what is the result? Resulting surface? Resulting surface is not sine, cosine wave anymore. It's a sharp crescent and a sharp trough. And if, for this data, if I will use a wavelet analysis to do this, to analyze this data, what I will get is the basic frequency and then the third harmonics. And if I have enough color resolution, I'll have 6 and I have 9 and so on and so forth. Now, if I use Hilbert's analysis, what I will get if I overlay this perfect, I will have this, a fluctuation. And this fluctuation is along the mean, which is the omega. But the frequency actually fluctuates up and down. Okay, now, I can use this wavelet with care. I can reconstruct the data. I can use this frequency fluctuation. I can also reconstruct the data. Now the explanation, the physical interpretation of this is totally different. This, the colored wavelet or Fourier based, will say you have a basic frequency, then you have harmonics, you have harmonics, you have harmonics. And if we use Hilbert, we'll say no, you don't have all that, you have one frequency, but that frequency is fluctuating, is modulating. And if I integrate all this, integrate the timeout, I will get this. A perfect analysis of that data give you basic, third harmonics, six harmonics, nine harmonics all the way down, if you have patience to plot. Okay? But the Hilbert will only give you just this. Since you have one frequency, but that frequency modulate, oscillate back and forth. Now this is just one example. Now we'll go one step further. We'll look at the Duffin equation. Duffin equation is one of the most elementary nonlinear dynamic system. That is x cube nonlinearity with forcing function gamma omega t. And for this, I will present a very simple-minded analogy to this system. This system is, if I factor 1x out, I have 1 plus epsilon x squared. And I will treat this as L. And what happens is that the L keeps changing in the whole process. And the L becomes large when x becomes large. So my pendulum moves in an exaggerated way like that. The epsilon is not necessarily small for my discussion. So the pendulum moves like this. And then that is as if somebody is putting the pendulum. And as a result, the frequency is changing everywhere. And if we use this, because this is a cubic nonlinear, nobody can solve it. So you put it in the computer, you grant out the answer is sharp crescent, sharp trough, the Diffie solution. Okay. Now, for this Diffie solution, I drive it very hard with the epsilon equal to 1. So the phase plan looks like this. It starts to go into be chaotic. And if I drive it more, it will actually bifurcate. And with that data, if I use the sifting program, what I will get? I will get the top one from 0 to 2, a very nice system oscillation. And the second one is from 0 to 0.2. That's the gamma cosine omega t. That's the forcing function. Okay. And then beyond the forcing function, I get a third component. And this third component is actually the subharmonics. The subharmonics has been derived before with a small epsilon by Kevorkian in the 60s. So for nonlinear problem, there is such a subharmonics. Now this problem, if we use wavelet, we, as I said, we will have the basic frequency and maybe this the forcing function and harmonics and harmonics. But if I use Hilbert spectrum, what do we got? We got, this is the forcing function, this is the subharmonics, and these are the minute frequency change, modulation, up and down. Then we'll ask, are these up and down really make sense? To see whether they make sense or not, we have to put this data back on top of it. And what you see is that the sum of the wave line up with a low frequency, other wave line up with a high frequency. Okay? If we push this up a little bit, then we see that this wave line up with low frequency and that wave with high frequency, the width of the wave are not the same. In other words, the nonlinear oscillation make this frequency, make this period very different. There are some narrow ones and some are wider. And that all represented by this minute change from point to point of the frequency. And of course, if we integrate this time out, we will have a different representation. The Hilbert spectrum gives you the subharmonics, the forcing function, and the first components, which is the fundamental components, but it's oscillated back and forth. This actually is the fluctuation of that frequency. And if we use Fourier, we have the forcing function, the fundamental, and all the harmonics. And if we use wavelet, and the wavelet will give us a very gentle envelope of the thing. Now, so this are the kind of differences we can see using different ways to represent the data. And having explained this, and I can draw a tentative conclusion of the different method. The different method compared in this table. In this, I listed Fourier analysis, wavelet, and Hilbert spectrum. And the decomposition, in Fourier, the decomposition is frequency space. In wavelet, most people would prefer to use this word scale. But fine, the scale actually is function of time, inverse that is frequency. So its decomposition is also scale frequency. And Hilbert transformation or Hilbert spectrum, the decomposition is in time space because we use the envelope and that's actually happening in time. And the basis, the Fourier, the basis is fixed, sine, cosine, and a fixed a priori. Before I see the data, as you give it me, I'm going to use sine, cosine. Okay? The wavelet is also fixed a priori. Now, when I present this at different places, there are many people working in wavelet. They say, no, hold it. Wavelet is not really fixed a priori. They are the so-called adaptive wavelet. But the adaptive wavelet, it turns out, is big dictionary of all wavelets. Okay. You look in the dictionary, you find one, you say, well, this fit my data the best. You have some formula to calculate the penalty function, you say, well, this is the best, I'm going to use that. But once you choose that, you're fixed. You're not at the liberty to change it anymore. Now, in this, in the Hilbert, the basis actually is based on the data and is derived from the data. And because it's based on the data and derived from the data, it's totally adaptive. Okay. And furthermore, and because it's time in time space, and this basis actually is a much superior filter for data. Because this decomposition is fixed a priori in frequency space. If I have a data, and the process is nonlinear. So as you see, I have many, many harmonics. Now if I say, oh, I have some noise at certain high frequency, so I chop out the high frequency to get rid of the noise. But by chop off the high frequency, you actually chop off the high harmonics as well. And because of that, even though you are in a far away place you chop off the high frequency, you actually downgrade your data even in low frequency if the process is nonlinear. If the process is linear, of course, they're independent. Now, the third is the frequency determination. In Fourier analysis, the frequency is determined by convolution of your data with the basis. And because it's a convolution, this convolution is global. And wavelet is also by convolution. The convolution is the so-called mother wavelet. So it's regional, it's within that wavelet. But here, the frequency is defined by time derivative of the phase function. Okay, so it's determined by differentiation. So this frequency is local. How local? It's so local that actually break away from the so-called uncertainty principle. I know that when I talk about uncertainty principle here, somebody say, well, what do you talk about? I'm not talking about the physical world uncertainty principle. I'm talking about the data analysis uncertainty principle. Ever since this famous uncertainty principle was on, everybody used the term. And if anybody is interested in uncertainty principle in data analysis, please read this book by Leon Cohen. The title is Time Frequency Analysis, published by Prentice Hall, 1995. Chapter 3 is called Uncertainty Principle. Yeah. And it proves that any method, if you use convolution, you will have this uncertainty. Because your range that you integrate with. And if you do not use that, then you can actually get a frequency. Just like the Duffin solution. You can actually see each point rather than say different, rather than say the frequency is average. And the presentation is energy, frequency, and this energy, frequency, and time. Wavelet indeed give you time. But this time is very smeared, or frequency is very smeared, or both are smeared as a compromise. Here, we have energy, frequency, time. The time is definite, frequency is definite, energy is definite. Okay, and then the feature extraction. That is, if I look at the data, I want to see how they change. Fourier, you cannot find any feature other than a averaged frequency. In wavelet, you can find the features if you use continuous wavelet. But if you use discrete wavelet, you will never find the feature. The feature is going to be so gross that you will not actually extract useful information. And in this Hilbert spectrum, yes, we can do that. And for non-stationarity, Fourier, we cannot get non-stationary. You have to assume that this data, whatever you get, repeat periodically, okay? Now, for wavelet, yeah, we can deal with some non-stationarity, but that non-stationarity is limited by the uncertainty principle and also the resolution and all that. This, yes, we can deal with non-stationarity as minute as we want. And for non-linearity, for Fourier, no, for wavelet, no. Why? Because you have already determined your basis. Now, once you determine your basis, then any change beyond that has to show up as harmonics. And harmonics does not always make sense in the physical process. In here, we say yes, we can deal with non-stationary, non-linear and non-stationary basis. Now, having said this, since here is everybody is interested in physics, I will venture a conclusion of what this method actually teach me. And this is part of a seminar that I give at Berkeley, Applied Mechanics. With this, I offer to you three views of nonlinear mechanics. The first view is the Fourier view. The Fourier view is the linear summation. You give me a nonlinear system, nonlinear equation, I cannot solve it. So I say, well, if you have a small perturbation, I will expand my answer out as x0 plus epsilon x squared and whatever. There are fancy ways to do that, multiple time scale and whatever. But after you linearize it, then each linearized equation gives you a sine cosine thing or some other functions. Then you sum this up and you get your final answer. And so I call the general as a Fourier view. That's the kind of method that when I was a graduate student back in the early 60s, that's the only method that we can use. But recently, that method, nobody wants to use that method anymore. For simple reason is that they do not want to study the small perturbation. They want to study large perturbation. They want to study bifurcation. They want to study chaos. So what happened then if we cannot solve that? No problem, we have a computer, right? So the second view is the Poincaré view. The Poincaré view is the current view of people study nonlinear mechanics. What happened is that you compute the orbit of your system, compute millions, millions, millions of points. And then on that, you make a cut, a Poincaré plan. And you see how this data penetrate the Poincaré plan. And you plot the locus of the Poincaré plan like this. Okay, this happens to be a Duffin oscillator. Okay, and you can plot this so many points. that you can look at the locus to see whether there's an attractor, strange attractor, whatever. And in fact, if you look at this, each of this line, there are actually small structures in there. The structure is almost fractal. So they are very happy to get this kind of picture. If you look at some books, they even plot this out in colors, look like art. Okay, this is the present way of looking at that, according to Punk review. But as you can see from the way that each time it passed through it, it only get 1 point. Each orbit will get only 1 point. And beyond that penetrating point, this orbit are free to do all kinds of things. So I propose maybe in the future we can provide a different view, a third view, that's the Hilbert view. The Hilbert view will give you the orbit point by point, its energy and its frequency. And it's not just the beginning and end point. And with that, maybe we can learn more about the process. If not, at least we have an additional view to the mechanics problem that's facing us. And with that, I conclude my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this interesting talk. Are there questions or comments?
Yes.
Yes.
In a limited way, you can deal with the non-stationarity, also with the Fourier method, if you slice up your data in the time domain, as they do in signal processing.
Oh, yes, yes. I did mention that, the spectrogram. But unfortunately, the spectrogram is a fixed window. With a fixed window, then you have redundancy for high frequency. But once you have a fixed window, the low frequency, you don't even cover one wave, right? So that is the objection that the wavelet people drive to home. They say, that's no good, so we should abandon that, use wavelet. The wavelet window is adjustable. So in the low frequency, it has much wider window, high frequency has narrow window. So the resolution is uniform. Okay, that's what I say, uniform resolution. Did I answer your question? Yeah, okay, thank you. Yes.
Do you have any efficient methods for calculating the Hilbert spectrum?
Yes. Before the talk, I talked to Dr. Dilala. This method, a simple method, I find, turns out it was patented by NASA. When I first come up with this method, I give free talks, give seminars at different universities. And finally, 3 years ago, I discussed this method at Caltech. A professor immediately dragged me to the side. He says, you should patent this method. I said, why? He said, well, this is patentable. I said, you must be kidding. So I went back to NASA. I talked to the patent lawyer. And the patent lawyer, after listening to me, says, yeah, it's patentable. I says, when did you first talk about this? I said, about 11 months ago. I said, well, in United States, once you open your mouth, you have 1 year to patent. But outside the United States, once you open mouth, it's gone. So the patent lawyer immediately filed a patent on the method. The patent has already been granted last year. It goes through many different processes. And right now, there are seven patents. Four has been filed, three is under preparation. The one that I'm preparing is for speech analysis and for music analysis and also for machine vibration. So NASA now has hired a small company to market this. The small company has write a MATLAB toolbox. Right now, they're trying it in the beta version. The company is called the Princeton Satellite in Princeton, New Jersey. Yeah.
So you should contact this company if you want an answer to your question.
2 years ago, actually a year ago, I'm giving away this thing free. Yeah. But then NASA said, no, 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 you cannot give it free. You got to go through this little company. Yeah.
Yes, a question there? No.
I'm sorry if you already said this, but I understand how you decompose onto the stasis that you do with the
spline.
Right, but
sifting, yeah.
There's a sifting method. How do you go from that to the time and frequency?
Oh.
I can see how you have these, the component of the particular basis element as a function of time. How do you bring down the frequency?
Once you get each component is that this intrinsic mode function, and it's you do a Hilbert transform, and in a Hilbert transform you get energy and phase.
So you're using the Hilbert transform.
Yes, yes. If you do not like Hilbert transformation, you don't have to. At Harvard University, is Monagos. He proposed an energy method, which basically treated the signal as sort of like a periodical function. Then you take a second derivative and divide by the data itself and a square root, and with some weighting function, you still get the local frequency. But the comparison that I've seen is not that convincing. So I still prefer Hilbert transform. Yeah.
A question there?
Yeah. Are you going to apply your analysis to the motion of particles in accelerators?
No. I'm not working in that field, and I know very little about it. Today is my big education. My knowledge increased maybe thousandfold. anybody want to use it, it's fine with me, but I don't have the background to do it.
There are a few accelerator physicists in the hall.
Oh, I see.
And I'm sure that they could profit from your method.
Well, if you have the detailed data, I propose this as a different view in addition to what we have. See, this morning when I saw the experimental facility, I saw on the screen all kinds of results, probability density function, spectrum, this and that. But we have to really remember spectrum, what does spectrum mean? Yeah.
Yes?
Yes.
You seem to be apologizing for your definition of the uncertainty principle in data analysis, but as far as I'm concerned, it corresponds very closely to the way I think of the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It's the same thing.
Yeah. But then Heisenberg uncertainty principle cannot be, I cannot get over with it. But in data analysis, I can get over with this bandpass and the location. I'm still limited by Nyquist, but not the quote unquote uncertainty principle. Okay.
Mathematically,
sure. Mathematically, is this. But then you see, because if I do not use convolution, then I'm not limited by that.
Is there any other question or comment?
Yes?
Yes.
Does the basis not being, I don't know what that causes, when you end up having some kind of redundancy with your intrinsic load functions that you have to take care of, does that cause, can you say anything about
the implications? Please say that again, I didn't get you. Oh, okay. That's a very good question. All the way, I didn't mention orthogonality. Okay. This intrinsic mode function is not exactly orthogonal. Why? Because if your decomposition is nonlinear, the orthogonality really doesn't work. Okay. Now, if, however, it's grossly unorthogonal, then you're going to run into problem that you may have negative energy. Okay, but fortunately for this, each time I check orthogonality, and the orthogonality is almost there. The reason is that the procedure is actually take a deviation from mean. Okay, in most of our analysis, we say the local deviation from the mean, the product average is zero. And I'm reaping the benefit of that kind of loose observation. I cannot prove exactly it's orthogonal or not orthogonal, but I'm pretty sure that it's not orthogonal exactly because this is nonlinear decomposition. Okay? Typical correlation between components are a couple of percent, so it's not serious. Okay? And this couple of percent sometimes positive, sometimes negative. So when you add it all together, the total energy leakage is even smaller.
Any other question? Well, if not, we thank Dr. Huang again.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, we do that all the time.
Yeah. But I think that